So I'd like to welcome Professor Irudaya Rajan. He is with the Center for Development Studies in Thiruvananthapuram in Kerala. And he's arguably the country's most authoritative voice as far as labor, employment, migrants, the pattern of migrants, all of this is concerned. And thank you very much, Professor, for joining us on The Lead. My first question, the burning hot topic today, migrant workers who are wanting to go back home, they've already begun to go back home by trains, the special trains that are being run for them. There are a lot of issues, a whole lot of chaos is, of course, happening. On one hand, the government is citing, you know, public health and public safety concerns, the safety concerns of the migrants themselves. And on the other hand, there are migrants, lakhs of them, who want to go home. So where do we draw a line as far as this is concerned in such an extraordinary pandemic situation?
You know, the lockdown period, somehow we have not recognized the problem of migrants. I think we have failed to recognize the role of migration in the economy and society. I think that is the basic thing. It has created a lot of tension among the migrants. Partly because, you know, you imagine that our Prime Minister has given what is called the Janata curfew on Sunday. And then Tuesday he came on the TV and told everybody be at home. And he should have given at least 3 to 4 days for the migrants to go back. Probably the real lockdown probably started on 5 days from the Wednesday. Probably we would have had very easy people moving. Yeah, you are giving them 5 days to settle down. Please remember that time the COVID was only less than 500. So even they would have gone home. It's entirely different scenario. Now we are talking them going home. For example, today anybody moves from Mumbai, Delhi or Bangalore and they are likely to carry COVID compared to 40 days back. I think this is where we have failed to recognize the migrants. Now that after 60 days of trouble, you know, there was so many trouble because the train started, they did not go. People were walking in the road, you know, people were, you know, even they died in the railway tracks. We know that there was a big tension among the migrants, among the states, both the sending states like Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, UP and the receiving states like Karnataka, you know, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, because they don't belong, you know, whom they belong. That's the biggest question. Why we should look after them? This is all biggest question they were facing. And finally, we saw the train started moving. And now, definitely, there is going to be a health threat. Definitely, there is no doubt about that because some of them might carry the COVID. Not just from within the country, because we have seen, even in Kerala, where I'm sitting right now, 3 days, there was zero COVID. But then we allowed the Pravasis to come, migrants from the Gulf, and also the people from other states. And the last 3 days, we had 19 COVID, new COVID. 7 first day, second day 7, and another day 5. If you take that together, 70% of them through people who came to Kerala 3 days back. So it is Kerala we are talking about. Definitely, people coming from other states, they are going to create a health problem. Now, how to avoid that? I think the migrants now know that they have suffered for 40 days. In the place, they are not familiar. They went to work. Yeah, this is not their place. Or people who came to Kerala, or people who came to Bangalore, they all came for short-term work or some construction work. Now they are going back and they know that the impact of COVID. So probably they will see to it, they will keep social distance because they know that. So, but in any case, there is going to be the COVID probably will reach rural areas, but it is our responsibility to see that it is not spreading at a community level.
Now, if you can just explain, initially India was saying that all of our COVID cases were imported. So the focus of the testing and screening was on people who had returned from abroad. And subsequently, it moved to different, you know, people who were exhibiting symptoms. Anyone exhibiting symptoms of COVID were being tested. Now, as you said, if the migrants had been allowed to go home, you know, just after the Janata curfew, for instance, do you not feel that perhaps there is a likelihood that, you know, the COVID would have moved to the rural areas where it is not there currently? But is it a possibility that this could have happened and perhaps that is what the government tried to do?
No, but I think there is a only hypothesis, because you remember that we were talking with 500 40 days back, now we are talking about 60,000. So there is a chance of transmitting to rural area is now the probability is very high. I think this is something we should keep in mind. But at the same time, as an expert working on migration, I'm not working on health. Health is another subject. But if you look at that, 40 days these people had no work. Now we are worrying about health. They may be worrying about their starvation, poverty. You know, they are going. This is the first time migrants are going back with the empty hand. Never, never in the history of India or history of any state, migrants, when they go home, they go with money. This time, they are not only going with empty hand, there is a suspicion that they are carrying COVID. There is a, you know, there is a stigma for them. You know, in fact, they have double stigma. Neither they have money and the family afraid to go near to them. Not only the family, even states don't want them. Many states said, don't come, be there where you are. For example, you know, for example, you remember that Maharashtra was talking about dropping the migrant in the border of each state. It's like we are talking about a country. We will drop you near the border of Orissa, you pick up your people. But nothing happened. Then the train started moving, people started moving. Then only the employers worried about them. When they were locked down, I don't think any employer came. For example, Kerala government were feeding 500,000 internal migrants in the worker camps and in the common kitchen. Please remember, they were not came to work in the Kerala government. They were all came to work with some employer. They sent them out. But then when they started going, what happened in Karnataka? Karnataka chief minister said there will be no train from Karnataka, because if the workers are going, there will be no construction. Of course, he has to withdraw the statement saying that the train will go. Because you cannot hold the migrant, because there's a right to move. But please remember, the employer were not taking care of them. I think COVID brought a biggest question. Whose responsibility looked after the migrants? Is it the employer who brought them? Or it is the state which is, they are staying, the states of destination like Kerala? Or it is the state which they are sending, like UP, Rajasthan, Bihar. Whose responsibility? I think this is something we have to, post-COVID-19, we should talk about that. Who is responsibility? And not only that, in our own country, first time, we have seen stranded migrants in other part of the state. I was talking to my friends in Tamil Nadu. There was a train went from Kerala to Northeast via Chennai. It reached Chennai, lockdown was announced. And the train was standing in the central station. That the people, the train will not go. How many days? We don't know. And all were coming to the platform with families, with old people, with children. And Tamil Nadu government has to accommodate them. Now, please remember, they were neither working for Tamil Nadu, nor they are not from Tamil Nadu. But they were stranded between, looked after by a state government which has nothing to do with them. Can you imagine in their own country they are stranded? I think this is where somehow all of us, as a policymaker, as an expert, both state and central government have failed to recognize the role migrants played in the country's economy, in the city economy. Today, can you imagine city like Bombay, Delhi without migrants? No, they were there. I think COVID brought them to the limelight. We know their problem, but right now, we know them, they are highly vulnerable. Highly vulnerable, and we can see them. And that is why we are talking, they are walking to their villages with empty hands. I think this is something very serious. Compared to the health crisis, we are going to get what I call them, probably the very deep depression is going to come in the villages. Because there will be no food. We are worried about them. For the poor people, it is not COVID-19. For the poor people, it is food in the table. So when we talk about between life and death, they are talking about livelihoods. Livelihood is the one they went out to make money. I think we have to seriously think about them. Even in the big package announced by yesterday, Chief Minister has announced, Prime Minister has announced 20 lakh crore program. I think we have to see that all the migrants are included in the package.
How do you see this happening? Is it time for a migrant policy, in a sense, which, you know, takes into account all the unique issues and the problems and the vulnerabilities that migrants in this country face?
No, we had this Interstate Migration Act, but otherwise, India, we don't have an articulated migration policy. Whose responsibility? For example, somebody arrives in Kerala. What are the responsibilities of the Kerala government? And who is bringing them? An employer, a contractor, whoever brings them. What is the responsibility? We have not laid down that type of policy. We are not laid down. That is why we are talking. For example, many of the workers were not received salaries for their 40 days. It is not they went on a strike. It is not they went on not to work. They are forced to sit at home, sit in the employment site, sit at some places, sit in the camps. But it is our responsibility to give them proper salaries. Even they don't work. We talk about homework. Please work at home. Migrant cannot work at home. They have to be outside. Like, for example, domestic worker. I cannot tell my domestic maid, you work at home, I will pay you salary. No. But we have to see that she is getting some money, though she is not able to come to work in my house. Because the domestic workers, construction worker, you know, the roadside workers. So I think we have to think about a policy, not only for them, we have to think of policy for them, the employment contract. Are they given regular employment? Are they are paid properly? Are they are getting health benefits? Are they living in a proper environment? Today we are talking about crowding place. They were all living in the crowding place. Many were staying in the construction site without proper light, sitting, sleeping with the dogs, and eaten by mosquitoes. We have seen them. But today we are talking about them because of the COVID-19. So I think we should give them a decent life at the place where they work. Life includes wages. Life includes some type of a proper employment, proper livelihood, and also the social security. Something they can carry when they get old. Today, when they get old, the migrants, they have nothing to fall upon. So we should even think of the end of their work. Can they have some type of, even a minimum, some pensions through their work, what they worked for so many years? When they are not able to work, when they are not able to migrate, they are almost like a end of their life, but they live another 10 to 15 years. So I think we have to think them very seriously. Unfortunately, all of us are migrant. In India, 450 million people are living in a place they are not born. One out of three people in this country are migrant. I am sure you are a migrant. I am a migrant from Tamil Nadu. I talk about Kerala problem, but I am a migrant to Kerala. That's why when people ask me why you are always talking about migrant, I said, I am a migrant. Luckily, I am in a better social security system, but there are migrants. They are not paid salaries. They are not given proper ventilation to, you know, I think COVID brought them to the limelight, and we should use this opportunity to bring policies for them so that post COVID-19, migrants have a better and bright future so that people are willing to migrate. Because the COVID is going to change the migration stream, definitely. No government can hold them. You can stop the train, but they will go. Because the migrants will go.